Hi, everyone. I am here with Donna Imam. You all know her already. She ran for Congress in 2020, and she is back running to represent the brand new district in Texas, District 37 now. Donna, welcome to the show.
Hey, Mike. Thank you so much for having me. I'm so glad to be back with the viewers of your show. They're the most amazing viewers, and they've shown me so much love last time. So thank you.
They are truly incredible, as are you. Your campaign last time just it exploded, I think, because people really saw that you had something special that you were offering to people, and you were so close. You got the most votes than anyone in that district before, at least, who was running as a progressive. And it was a district that was so close to flipping. But now it's a little bit of a different game because this is a brand new district. The lines were just redrawn. Yeah. So talk about the dynamic this time, because it's a whole different race now.
Yeah. So, you know, the population of Texas grew in a big way in the last decade. In fact, Texas, I believe, is the only state that got two new U.S. congressional districts in addition to the 36 that they already have. And Austin, Texas got one of those brand new districts. So I have been redistricted into a completely brand new district, which race is not just critical to winning for Democrats. This is a Democrat, opportunity to pick up a seat in Texas, of all places. Not only that, but the road through flipping Texas, or what I like to say, taking back Texas, runs right through this district. So this is a really, really exciting opportunity. And guess what? I mean, whoever wins this district on March 1st, and early voting for us starts on February 14th, if you can believe it or not, like right after Christmas.
Wow.
they go straight to Congress because this is a Democratic-leaning district.
And you have already shown that you could win a Democratic primary, because that's exactly what you did in 2020. So talk about what happened last time. I know that my viewers are familiar with your campaign, but give us a little bit of a refresher and just how close you were.
Yeah, so, you know, Texas's 31st district was Northwest Austin suburbs, all of Williamson County and almost all of Bell County. And I ran in that district. We beat out 11 other candidates. You know, there was a total of 6 candidates on the ballot. We made it to a runoff, and then we won that, you know, primary runoff with a double digit lead. And we definitely were not the favorite to win. And believe it or not, Mike, you know, the viewers on your show played a huge part in our race. They got out the word all over the country. We had so much love, so much support. And you will not believe the number of letters, handwritten letters, that we got from viewers of your show saying, "Donna, I saw you on the Humanist Report, and I loved what you're doing." So, you know, in 2020, we outperformed, all the races in Texas. Let me tell you how. The data speaks for itself, right? In the primary, we had the highest voter turnout in the history of the district, highest Democratic voter turnout. In the primary runoff, we had the highest voter turnout in the history of the district. Runoff to runoff, 200%+ improvement in voter turnout. And get this, not only did we have the highest voter turnout in the history of the entire district, but Williamson County, all of which was in my district, was number one in voter turnout among the top 25 most populated counties in Texas. Now, a lot of people are like, you know, Texas is a big state and it has over 200 counties. But most of our counties are very, very rural with very tiny populations. So when you're number one among the top 25 most populated counties, you're number one in Texas. And why is turnout so important? Because even though in 2020, Texas had really amazing voter turnout, we're still in the bottom 10 of all the 50 states in terms of voter turnout. Our voter turnout needs to improve in order for us to take back Texas. And so what does that mean? Texas is so gerrymandered that every single race, whether it's at the state level, U.S. rep or U.S. congressional or even state senate, right? Every single one of those races are completely predetermined to go one way or the other. So they've been cut in a way where basically GOP, people who have won will keep winning. And if there is a Democrat in there, they'll keep winning. So how do you take back Texas? The only way to do it is by flipping statewide seats. Now, guess what? Statewide, there's no gerrymandering. So if you can get out the vote, if you can get the highest voter turnout in the bluest parts of Texas, you can flip the state. And I can give you specific examples, by the way, on how we can do that. For example, the governor's race is on the ballot in 2022. In 2018, Beto O'Rourke ran for senator against Ted Cruz, and he was only short 215,000 votes. Now, that sounds like a lot. But by my calculations, just in the Austin area, Travis and Williamson County, there are over 100,000 Democratic voters that are registered to vote that did not come out in 2018. And we got to get them out. So if we can even get half of those people out in 2022, pair that with San Antonio, Behar County, pair that with, Dallas-Fort Worth, the bluest areas there, and Houston and El Paso, guess what? We close that gap. And all of a sudden, now we have a lot more say in the Texas legislature. So that's why it is so critical. And that's why I believe that our campaign is in the best position to get out the vote. Because after all, we did come in number one.
Yeah. Yeah. And you know, out of all of the districts in Texas, I believe that Texas, and correct me if I'm wrong, they doubled the amount of safe seats for Republicans. So I'm thinking that in these really safe blue districts, the new ones, there's going to be a lot of people who want to jump in. But one thing that I love is that you've already proven that you can beat out a lot of contenders. You've proven that you could drive up turnout. And so this is something that, like, I'm looking at this and I feel like this is such a good opportunity. I mean, this is one of those instances where a candidate comes back and in the second round, they nail it. I mean, Cori Bush came back, won. Ro Khanna came back and won. So for me, I've always had this belief that if you're running for Congress, it's hard to win that first time. But if you are going to run and you want to win, usually the second or third time is when you do it. But you almost won the first time. So the second time, you've already crunched the numbers. You're an engineer. So you're thinking specifically about what you need to do, where the weaknesses are, where to drive up turnout. And it looks like such a good opportunity. And I feel like more progressives should be following this race because this could be huge for us. So, okay, I want to jump ahead a little bit. Let's assume that you are elected in 2022, you're sworn in 2023, but then overall Democrats lose the House. So you're in this position where you're in Congress, you're in a position to really make change, but the party that you're caucusing with is not in power. What do you do from there in that meantime when, there's going to be nothing done, essentially? What do you think is the best move for you as a lawmaker? Where do you direct the momentum towards? Because there's a lot of things that need to be addressed. I mean, climate change and Medicare for All, you already know. Where would you kind of focus your attention?
That's a great question, Mike, and such a pertinent one too. But to answer that question, I want to share a letter that I got from a lady in Texas. And you'll know why this letter is going to be so important to answering your question. So I got this letter earlier this year, and this is a beautifully handwritten letter. I don't know if you can see this here.
I can. That's awesome.
Yeah, so I'll read it to you because it's a tiny letter and your readers will be able to appreciate this. She says, Donna, I lost my job because of my age. I'm 78 years old, so I can't give much. Please accept this small donation. She sent this with a check.
Oh, wow.
She says, not sure I will be able to find a job at my age. If I do, I will be able to continue to support your campaign. Good luck, Jane. People ask me, why I'm running. And when you get letters like this, what can you do but not keep fighting? Fighting for Texans, fighting for the people that depend on you. And so let's say the Democratic Party loses and we don't have the majority. We still have a lot of work to do. We need to talk about the people in our country, specifically Texans. You know, we have the most number of people with no health care. And even if we don't have majority, it is our responsibility. It is our obligation to talk to people, even if it's across the aisle, even if they're extreme on the other side, and explain to them what is happening to people in our country, that people don't have the ability to go see a doctor when they get sick, that at an age where she should be relaxing, she's still worried about finding a job. That's right. Can we give up? Isn't it important? Isn't it our job to reach across the aisle and make sure that they come on board? Today, the GOP has no solution for healthcare. We must educate voters. We must take our message to voters, whether we are in power or not. And we have to keep working. And this is why I will never give up working for Texans and Americans across this country, because they are depending on us. They're looking for somebody to go in and explain what is happening in this country. And it's not like people in Congress don't necessarily know this, but it is important to hear from people. And it's important for us to keep going. So when you ask, what would I do in Congress? I would continue to advocate. I would continue to educate among the Democratic caucus. We know in the Democratic caucus that we have many people right now that don't support single-payer healthcare. They keep asking the question, how are you going to pay for it? When we know that we're overpaying for healthcare in this country. We're paying over $4 trillion for healthcare, leaving out millions from healthcare, not health insurance. And it's all great to be able to improve the amount of money that you give to ACA to help you bring down your premiums. But health insurance, and you know this, Mike, is not healthcare. Health insurance is not healthcare. And we have to take this to every single member of Congress, make sure that they really understand that the people in this country are suffering when they don't need to, that we don't need to find a way to pay for healthcare because we are already paying for it. So that will be my job in Congress, to reach out to every single person in the Democratic caucus, but also to reach out to anybody on the other side that wants to solve problems and take the message to both Democratic voters as well as voters that vote for the GOP, Republican voters. And I think that is our obligation, and we must do it.
Yeah. Honestly, why I think that you really resonated with a lot of people is because there's this sense that politicians and anyone who wants to get involved in politics, they're either career-minded and, you know, opportunistic, and they don't even bother trying to speak with them. I mean, for example, my representative is a Democrat, and I don't even bother sending her a letter because I know that if I sent her a letter, even if I put a check in it, she'd just take the check and then throw away the letter. But people like you actually read the letters. It actually has a real emotional impact on you, and the difference is so clear. You're a human being. These other folks are robots, and I think that really resonates with people because they're sick of the robots. So with that in mind, assuming you're in Congress, assuming you were in a position where Democrats actually did have the majority and you could actually get some things done, I want to propose a hypothetical situation to you that I've been asking a lot of candidates running for Congress, and I think it's really interesting. They've answered in a variety of ways, and each time it's very fascinating to me. So I'm curious. So let's say that you have a piece of legislation that you introduced, and you're trying to get a lot of sponsors. You're trying to get committee hearings for it. But one individual who's a holdout but a potential co-sponsor is someone who is being primaried. It's a corporate Democrat, but yet there's somebody who is very left-wing who would certainly sponsor that legislation but is unlikely to win that seat. Mm-hmm. In this situation, what do you do? Do you endorse that person to get them to co-sign? Do you concoct this sort of a deal, or do you kind of disregard their co-signing of your legislation and endorse the incumbent, or not the incumbent, I'm sorry, endorse the primary over the incumbent, knowing that your endorsement as a member of Congress could give them a giant boost and make the difference? In that situation, what do you do? Because it's a moral dilemma in the sense that, you know, you need co-sponsors. If you want to get things done, you need to build support for these bills. But at the same time, if we don't have more people in Congress that are like-minded, uncorrupted, then you're also not going to go anywhere. So in this situation, how would you individually navigate this? Because it's tough. I feel like, you know, this is part of the reason why AOC didn't endorse Cori Bush in 2020 over Lacey Clay, because he co-sponsored the Green New Deal. So maybe she thought, or maybe he did that to get her to remain silent. I don't know. You know, we don't know what goes on behind the scenes, but how would you handle this situation?
So this is a really great question, and I want your viewers to understand what sponsorship actually means, or endorsements actually really mean. There's two kinds of ways that endorsements can help. One is where you have a major well-known name, and that actually helps you get votes. Now, I want you guys to understand this. To get votes, endorse the actual impact of endorsement on votes is very minimal. Because that endorsement, unless every single person in that district that you're running hears and knows about this, that endorsement, and sometimes we assume just because we have it on our website or on our social media, everyone's heard of it. That is not true. Because when we ran in 2020, we hit over 50,000 homes in Williamson County. And why did we do that? Because we believe that we needed to get our message to where the voters are. We didn't depend on media because we knew that we wouldn't get any media coverage, right? So unless you take your endorsement, and then the second step of this is that the person reading about that endorsement has to either like the person that's endorsing you, believe in them, or it has to have a positive effect, right? And when it comes to politicians, it's always a dilemma. You do not know which politician has a positive effect and which one has a negative effect. Just because somebody is a Democrat doesn't mean that they will necessarily have a positive effect when it comes to votes, okay? That is votes. So next, I wanna talk to you about money. Money is a really important part, especially if you're a grassroots candidate trying to raise money. And you know, last time when I ran, I was a first-time candidate. I had no exposure. And your viewers, by the way, hundreds of your viewers gave me tiny, tiny, small contributions, and you have no idea what that did for our campaign. You literally breathed life into our campaign and helped us get over that primary and get into our runoff and then win. So you were part of this success that we have been able to show so far, and we could not have done it without you. So when a congressperson endorses, the endorsement itself will not raise you any money unless they go to bat for you and help you raise money. So a lot of times, you know, we're on social media, we're plugged into all of this, political news, and we get excited. We see an endorsement and we say, okay, this is great. You know, she got an endorsement from somebody that we respect and we want, you know, them to go in and caucus with. But that doesn't necessarily mean that it results in good fundraising numbers or votes. The only time that an endorsement really matters, number one, is if the person who endorses you has great name recognition and will go to bat and raise money for you. So there are very few Congress members that will actually do that for you, where they will send an email and raise money for you. And if they raise money for you, absolutely, that will make an impact. So if I was in Congress and I had the ability to raise millions and millions of dollars, and I knew that there was a chance that this person, if I helped them financially, that they would win this race, right? I could actually have a real impact in their race. Then in order to pass things like single-payer healthcare, which is one of my biggest focuses, right, in actually making it happen, not just talking about it, but how do we go inside Congress, organize, build support for it, right? If I believe that I could actually impact that path to success, then absolutely we should support them in ways that is meaningful, not just putting our name on it, but actual meaningful endorsement. That's number one. But we have to try everything. For example, if we have an incumbent and that incumbent is not coming on board to what needs to be done for the American people, we absolutely have to do everything to encourage that person, to show them the data, to bring them on board. And if we're unable to do that, yes, they need to step away, and we need to bring in people that are going to act in the way the data is directing them. And we all know this, you know this, Mike, and I've said this over and over again while on your show and outside, and so have many other candidates. There is absolutely no reason for us not to have single-payer healthcare in this country. That is my core issue. There is no reason why education should cost anything. I know people like to talk about free college, but the fact is education should be cost free. It should be debt free, not just because we can do it, because we can do it. Because guess what? Calculus and mathematics and physics and majority of engineering hasn't changed in the entire century. There is no reason why we are paying tens of thousands of dollars and loading up our kids in this country, young people with mortgage-sized loans, so they can go get an education. It's ridiculous. And if you have Congress members that don't see that, then they have no business being in Congress because they are actively harming the progress of our country.
And I love your answer because you know more than somebody who doesn't like, who just kind of like runs for Congress and they're kind of bright eyed and they get there and then their soul is crushed. Like, I feel like you already know to anticipate your soul will be crushed. You're going to have a lot of manipulative people in Congress and you're really playing the long game, right? You're not thinking about, okay, in this 2-year term, how many co-sponsors can I get on this piece of legislation? You're thinking, how can I actually get this legislation passed and not just have something to write to my constituents about, hey, we got 68 co-sponsors on my legislation, when, okay, that's going to reset in a couple of years and you're going to have to get that again. And like, you're thinking about the long game. And this is why I think that so many of my viewers really value you. So, okay, every single person who's watching this, they already are convinced 100%. So now the only question is, how do we make this official this time? What do you need specifically from us? Because this is a new district. Do you need volunteers? Do you need money? Help us help you. How do we make you go across that finish line this time, like, for sure?
So this race is completely winnable. Whoever wins this primary will go to Congress. There's no doubt about that, number one. I've already made my case. We had the highest voter turnout in the history of the district, right? And we need to repeat that, not just to win this race, but also to help take back Texas and help other Democrats win statewide, which is important in Texas for a couple of reasons. Number one, our voter rights have been further restricted. We need to take those back. Reproductive rights have been completely banned for Texans. That is a huge challenge for us. And of course, we've been gerrymandered to the max, which means Democrats in Texas have zero power. So this is a really, this is not just about winning a race. This is about, you know, really bringing back some normalcy to Texans. We are under siege here right now. So how can we help? If you are in Austin, Texas, I ask you to join our campaign and let 10 of your friends know about me running. If they haven't heard, get them out to vote. Early voting starts February 14th. That is the most important thing of anything. Nothing wins races like votes, okay? Mm-hmm. Votes win races. So that's number one. Number two, if you can help and are able to contribute anything at all, we would really, really appreciate it. Every single dollar counts. And Mike, you know me. We, in our campaign, stretch the dollar more than I think any other campaign. We have really, really optimized every single dollar. It costs about a dollar for us to reach a voter. So even if you can donate a dollar, and if you're, you know, really, really wealthy, please feel free to donate more. We do need help. We're trying to get on the ballot. Our deadline to get on the ballot is December 13th. So if you can contribute, please do at votefordonna.com. So that's one thing. But the most important thing out of all this is, even if you're across this country and you have a friend, a relative, a cousin, anybody in Austin, please call them, text them, message them, Facebook them, let them know that we're running and that we can get this job done, not just for this race, but also for all of Texas. And my promise to you, Mike, and your viewers is that I will be the person in Congress that will advocate on every single day to make legislation around single-payer healthcare happen. That is one of my biggest focuses. And the second thing is debt-free education, cost-free education. That doesn't matter if you want to go to trade school, college. I think one of the biggest mistakes for Democrats is not to pass tuition-free community college in Build Back Better. That is one of my favorite things in there. And those are my two big things that I will be advocating for, strategizing, convincing to get passed. So that's my goal in Congress, and I hope that we can make it happen for you. And thank you so much. If you supported our campaign last cycle, you have no idea what you did for our campaign. You moved our campaign to become number one in Texas. Think about
that. That's insane.
That's insane, right?
That's great. It goes to show you that if you have a good message and you know what you're doing, you can go the distance. So Donna, of course, I mean, we'll be in touch. I'll be watching your campaign very, very closely. And hopefully we'll be able to bring you on after you win the primary, because then it's just smooth sailing.
Hope so. Well, thank you so much.
You'll be racing to the finish line as that car drove by.
Yes, thank you so much, Mike. I really, really appreciate it. And lots of love to your viewers.
Yes, you as well. Thank you so much, Donna.